بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته أبنائي طلب التالتة. دي آخر محاضرة إن شاء الله في السيستودز، وهنتكلم فيها عن الهيداتيك ديزيز أند دايفيلوبوثريوم ليتوم. The objectives of the present lecture: by the end of the lecture you should be able to classify cystodes and know the difference between intestinal and tissue cystodes. Describe the morphology of the different types of hydatid cyst. Explain the life cycle of Echinococcus granulosus and multilocularis. Give the diagnosis and treatment of hydatid disease. Describe the morphology and the life cycle of Diphyllobothrium latum. And give the diagnosis and treatment also of Diphyllobothrium latum. Discuss the prevention and the control of the parasites discussed in this lecture. بنتكلم عن الكلاسيفيكيشن اوف سيستودز كنوع من الريفريشمنت. في تو اوردرز مهمين او قسمين مهمين في السيستودز، وهم سايكلوفيليديا اند سودوفيليديا. سايكلوفيليديا دي اللي بنتكلم فيها حاليا، واخر شغل لنا فيها في محاضره النهارده. خدنا فيها التينيا ساجيناتا والتينيا سوليوم، وخدنا الهيمونوليب سبيشيز. النهارده الكلام عن إيكينوكوكس سبيشيز، إيكينوكوكس جرانيولوزس اند مالتي لوكولاريز، ذا لارفال ستيج اوف ويتش از ذا هيداتيك سيست ويتش انفكت مان. الانسان هنا بياخد العدوى باللارفال ستيج وليس بالادلت بارازايت. الاوردر الثاني سودو فيليديا، الاوردر الثاني سودو فيليديا اللي هي الاخيره اللي فيها دايفيلوبوثريوم ليتوم. لازم نلاحظ ان الانسان في السيستوز may be infected with the adult parasite only في حالات تينيا ساجيناتا، هيمنوليبس ديمينيوتا، دايبليديام كاناينم، دايفيلوبوثريوم ليتوم. الانسان ممكن ياخد العدوى باللارفال ستيج only in the cases of hydatid cyst which is a larva of Echinococcus, Sinura cerebralis دي يمكن مش مقرر عليكم، and Sparginum ايضا دي تشالت. احيانا الانسان ممكن ياخد العدوى بالادلت بارازايت اند لارفا، في الحاله دي الانسان بيبقى ديفينيتيف اند انترميديت هوست، وده في حالات التينيا سوليوم الانسان ممكن ياخد العدوى بالادلت وممكن ياخد العدوى باللارفا سيستي سيركوزس، وفي حالات الهيمنوليبس نانا during the life cycle of اتش نانا. نقدر نرجع نقسم السيستودز تقسيم اناتوميكال، بنقول اناتوميكال كلاسيفيكيشن. According to the site of infection, cystodes may be intestinal cystodes or tissue cystodes. Intestinal cystodes which are adult parasites. They include Tinea saginata, Tinea solium, Hymenlips nana, Hymenlips diminuta, Diplidium caninum, and Diphyllobothrium latum. All of them inhabit the small intestine of the definite host, including man. Small intestine. Tissue cystodes يعني الإنسان واخد العدوى باللارفا في حالات السيركس سيليولوزا اللي هي بتسبب سيستي سيركوزس، الهيداتيد سيست which is a larva of Echinococcus اللي هي الهيداتيد ديزيز، السينيوراس، سبارجينم، and as we said سيستي سيركويد. But this is not a disease, but it is a transitional stage during the life cycle of Hymenolepis. دي كلها inhabit different tissues of the intermediate host, including man. Now we start with human hydatidosis or hydatid disease. بنعرف الhydatid disease or hydatidosis، بنقول it is the infection of man with the hydatid cyst which is the larval stage of cystodes of the genus Echinococcus. هنا بنقول genus Echinococcus لان هيبقى فيه two species later on. Number one، في نوعين، unilocular hydatid disease ده بيتسبب by unilocular hydatid cyst which is the larva of Echinococcus granulosus. Multilocular hydatid disease caused by multilocular hydatid cyst which is the larva of Echinococcus multilocularis. And this is the geographical distribution. Some areas are highly endemic. Some areas have a moderate endemicity and some areas are free of infection. Sometimes they detach and become floating in the lumen. Some cysts inside the cyst contain no structures inside. These are called the sterile cysts. This depends on the immunity of the host. Sometimes one cyst of the daughter cyst may pass to the outside, may herniate to the outside from a weak point in the wall. This is called exogenous daughter cyst. This is the morphology of the hyalacis, and the size starts with about 1 centimeter, may reach to 10 centimeter. In big size, it may reach to 20 or 25 centimeters in diameter. This is a stained section of the hyalacis cyst showing connective tissue reaction or tissue reaction around. This is the wall, external layer of the wall, which is the laminated layer. This is the lumen containing the fluid. These are the capsules containing the scoliosis inside. This is another section showing also tissue reaction around. This is the wall, and these are capsules containing protoscoliosis, and these are free scoliosis in the lumen of the hydrated intermediate host occurs through ingestion of the eggs. Infection of the definitive host occurs when the definitive host will eat the tissues of dead animals containing hydatid cysts. Now the adult will be formed in the definitive host. Intermediate host, the adult will again be formed inside the definitive host. Here man is an accidental intermediate host. When he accidentally ingests the eggs of Echinococcus granulosus, man may be also infected with the hydatid, and he will act as an human infection. Man is an accidental intermediate host, and human infection occurs by ingestion of the eggs of Echinococcus granulosus through either direct contact with dogs or ingestion with vegetables or of vegetables contaminated with these eggs. This is the egg of Echinococcus, which is quite similar to the egg of Tinea species. Development and common sites of hydatid cyst. Hatching of eggs after ingestion will occur. The oncosphere, which is the embryo, will be liberated. It will penetrate the intestinal wall, pass with the portal circulation. يعني blood and lymphatic, mainly the portal circulation into the liver, where the oncosphere settles and develops into the hydatid cyst. In about 50% or more of cases, development of the hydatid will occur in the liver. Some of these oncospheres will escape the liver, passes with the inferior vena cava and reaches the lung to develop inside the lung. Thus, the lung is the second common site for the development of hydatid cyst. Others, or the remaining, will escape into the systemic circulation to be disseminated and settle in different organs like the brain, the kidney, bone, and so on. Full development of the cyst will occur in about 5 to 9 months. The hydatid cyst is a cystic structure. When it grows, it will press on the surrounding tissues in any organ. Early phase, when it is small, may be asymptomatic. الإفكتس إفكتس ماي بي ميكانيكال إفكتس ديو تو بريشر نيكروزس leading to deterioration of function. Pressure effects will lead to obliteration of ducts like blood vessels, like veins, like ducts and so on, and the pressure symptoms. According to the site, liver cyst causes hepatomegaly and related symptoms. Lung cysts cause chest pain, cough and so on. Cerebral cyst will lead to a neurological manifestation. It acts as a space-occupying lesion like a brain tumor. Complications of hydatid cyst may arise from compression on the surrounding structures and or rupture. Rupture of hydatid cyst, if there is slow leakage of hydatid fluid, it will lead to hypersensitivity reaction or allergic reaction. And sudden rupture may cause anaphylactic reaction, which may lead to even death of the patient, and also will lead to spread of infection to the neighboring sites. Secondary infection of the cyst will lead to abscess formation. Affection of different organs, complications may arise in other organs like the bone. There may be pathological fracture. Hepatic cyst may lead to compression of the common bile duct, leading to, for example, obstructive jaundice. Compression of blood vessels may lead to ischemia and thrombosis. Cardiac involvement may lead to pericardial effusion, complete heart block, and even sudden death. Finally, the fate of hydatid cyst in some points. Spontaneous cure may occur due to strong immunity of the host. Secondary infection and abscess formation is a second complication or one of the fate of hydatid cyst. Hydatid cyst may shrink and calcify and end in a dead body in the inside the host. Rupture and dissemination also is one of the fate of hydatid cyst. Thus, fate of hydatid cyst may spontaneous cure, secondary infection and abscess formation, shrinkage and calcification, may be rupture and dissemination. An important note here to note that infection spreads from the intermediate host to the definitive host, as we said. But in man, he is an intermediate host, but he is considered a dead end. Is a blind or a dead end for the parasite, since the cycle will not be completed. Thus, man is considered a blind host. The diagnosis, number one, clinical diagnosis, history of contact with dog symptoms, referring here chest pain, there is right abdominal or hypochondrial pain, and so on, according to the site. Hydatid thrill, this is a clinical sign. يعني شرحها إذا أنتوا في الجراحة إن شاء الله حيبقى في الفلكتويشن تيست فور ديتكشن أوف أبسس اللي هو أنا بحدد وجود فلويد إنسايد أسيست. This is what's called the hydatid thrill. It is felt by the clinician when the hydatid thrill occurs in the abdomen and superficially. This clinical diagnosis. Direct laboratory diagnosis by puncture and aspiration of the contents sonar guided يعني تحت السونار with precautions, لأن احنا عارفين ان the release will lead to sensitization or hypersensitivity reaction and microscopic examination for detection of protoscolices. Indirect, which depends mainly on the detection of antigen or antibody in the circulation. Number one, Kazuni intradermal test, which is an immediate hypersensitivity reaction similar to اختبار الحساسية بتاع البنسلين which is done and local reaction is noted in the form of erythema, edema, induration and itching. This is Kazuni intradermal test. Kazuni intradermal test is an old test, which has been replaced recently by serological tests. Serological tests for detection occurs for detection of antibodies like ELISA, indirect immunofluorescence, and so on. The detection of antigen or immune complexes, طبعاً, is more specific as it indicates the presence of a fresh or active or a viable infection. Other methods for diagnosis like PCR, which is very accurate and indicates the presence of active or viable infection. Also, there is peripheral blood eosinophilia during examination for CBC. Radiological diagnosis is very important, which is the imaging procedures which include X-ray عادية. ده في حالة الكالسيفيكيشن. Also fluid level in the system may be noted. Ultrasonography is very important, especially in abdominal cyst. Computerized tomography CT and MRI is very essential, especially in extra abdominal cysts like cysts in the chest, the brain, and so on. Finally, we can say in diagnosis, very important points in diagnosis, the most important points for diagnosis are serology, PCR, and the imaging procedures. This is an X-ray chest showing the outlines of a cyst in the left lung. This is an X-ray in the lower end of the femur. And these are vacuoles due to the presence of hydatid cyst. This is a long bone showing pathological, as we have said, pathological fracture, which is a complication of infection of the long bone. This sonar of the abdomen showing boundaries of the hydatid daughter cysts or broad capsules. This is a sonar also in the liver showing what's called floating membrane sign. Here is the cavity, and this is the detached germinal layer forming what's called the float. This is an X-ray of the skull showing a calcified hydatid cyst in the brain. Another CT of the brain showing a cyst in high doses, which may be repeated later on. Drugs may be also used pre-operatively. These are surgical excision of hydatid cyst. These are hydatid cyst protruding from a wound during operation. This is a hydatid cyst in the liver. After that, the control. Avoid contact with dogs because infection of man occurs mainly through contact with dogs. Proper washing of vegetables because infection also may occur through ingestion or consumption of contaminated vegetables. Close supervision of slaughterhouses, لأن في بعض السلخانات الفسرة والحاجات دي بيرموها outside السلخانة, تيجي stray dogs تاخدها, يبقى cycle may be transmitted to the definitive host. And also eradication of stray dogs and deworming of pet dogs. After that is called Echinococcus multilocularis, present in certain areas in Europe, Asia, and America. Foxes are the main definite force of Echinococcus multilocularis. Dogs and wolves and are reservoir hosts. Rodents are the intermediate host. Now foxes are the definite host and rodents are the intermediate host. Man may be accidentally through contact with foxes in forest. الصيادين في الغابات لما بيصطادوا الثعالب وبيسلخوا الثعالب عشان ياخدوا الفراء بيحصل لهم contamination with eggs of this parasite and they are infected with the multi multilocular hydatid cyst, and this is the life cycle of Echinococcus multilocularis. Definite host are foxes, and the intermediate host are rodents like rats and so on, and accidental infection extend to different these are the hydatid disease and different types of hydatid. Second subject in this lecture is the Diphyllobothrium natum, which is the second order of cystodes, which is called pseudophyllidia. The difference between cyclophyllidia, previously studied, and pseudophyllidia now, the difference relies in morphology and biology, life cycle. In the morphology, scolex is globular in cyclophyllidia. Here it is elongated. organs of attachment here, we know they are suckers. Here they are called Bothria or longitudinal grooves on the scolex, but no suckers. Hooks may be present. Here hooks are absent. The mature segment, genital opening on the lateral side, here on the ventral surface. The uterus blind, no uterine pore. No uterine pore, but in pseudophilia, uterine pore is present. Vitelline glands are present in mass here, but here they are dispersed. Gravis segment present in cyclophilia, they are absent in pseudophilia. The eggs here are non-operculated and mature. Here the eggs are operculated but immature. Intermediate host, in each parasite of cyclophilia, there is one intermediate host, but in pseudophilia, there are always two intermediate hosts, procercoid and pleurocercoid. The differences. Now, Diphyllobothrium latum, or called broadfish tapeworm, which is an example of pseudophilia. Geographically, they are present in northern Europe, Scandinavia, Baltic states, Russia, let's say in northern areas in certain sites of the world. They are not widespread like unilocular hydatid cyst. Is broader than long and no. After fertilization, the eggs pass from the uterus to the outside through a certain pore. The uterus opens individual of the common genital pore, and the eggs are, which are fertilized but immature, are released into the small intestine of the definitive host, which is man, and pass out with the stool to complete the life cycle. This is the scolex with longitudinal shaped. This is the rosette-shaped uterus. This is the egg of Diphyllobothrium latum, 70 by 50 micron, oval and operculated, yellowish brown, and they are fertilized but immature. Fertilized, يعني لازم يكون حصل fertilization وعندي zygote. This is called fertilized. Immature, the embryo has not yet developed inside the egg. It is called fertilized but immature. This is a coracidium. Coracidium, which is the embryo that will be formed inside the egg, and it will be released later on. It's spherical, 80 to 90 micron, covered with cilia and has six hooks. This is a procercoid, which is considered the first larval stage of Diphyllobothrium latum. It is a solid organism, about 500 micron, and has a caudal end with six hooks. And it is the infective stage. Now the life cycle, definite host is man and rodents, fish-eating animals. Habitat is the small intestine. Intermediate host, there are two intermediate hosts. First intermediate host cycle, second intermediate host, salmon, fish. Larval stages, coracidium, which is the embryo. Then the first larval, true larval stage is a procercoid in cyclops. The second larval stage is a pleurocercoid in fish. Infective stage is a pleurocercoid, and the mode of infection is through ingestion of properly cooked fish containing by fish, to, which is the final or the second larval stage, inside which the pleurocercoid will develop. And now man will be infected through ingestion of fish containing viable pleurocercoid. Pleurocercoid will develop in the small intestine into the adult Diphyllobothrium latum. These are the cyclops. Then after that, clinical aspects of Diphyllobothriasis. First, in the start of infection, it may be asymptomatic. Even maybe just vague abdominal pain, nausea, and diarrhea may be present. Complications, the main complication of the Diphyllobothrium latum infection is megaloblastic anemia, which occurs due to vitamin B12 deficiency, which is the most important clinical problem. Vitamin B12 deficiency occurs through impaired absorption due to the presence of the worms. Also, the worms consume big amounts of vitamin B12. Intestinal obstruction may occur, which is rare, and also neurological manifestations may occur due to absorption. The diagnosis occurs clinically by history of eating raw fish, especially in endemic area. Also, the presence of megaloblastic anemia. Laboratory diagnosis occurs mainly through the detection of eggs. Sometimes segments may be released, but it is rare. The treatment is a medical treatment using praziquantel in a single dose, 10 mg per kilogram, and it is the drug of choice. Niclosamide or Yumizan is another choice. The control of the phylobothrium latum lies in certain points, safe sewage disposal to prevent the start of the life cycle, proper cooking and freezing of fish before consumption to kill any pleurisulcoids presence, diagnosis and treatment of patients, and control of reservoir hosts. I thank you. Wa assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.